Shabbat Shalom. Good morning, and thank you for inviting me here. I'm quite excited to speak here in front of so many Israeli friends, and I promise that my English is not so fluent like English of Itamar Marcus. Sorry. I will speak only from my personal experience and what I learned since I was enlisted in 79. And you will see maybe direct lecture. I want to speak as an ordinary person to ordinary people. And this is not so academic. So excuse me if we are jumping from one topic to other. As you see, I was many years in the army. I finished my regular service as a lieutenant colonel, and then I got to the business, and after it, I went to a real security problem of Israel. Now I'm a teacher in high school, and I believe that the power is not in F-16 or F-35. The power is in our kids, in our young people. They are creating our future. And the only one person who was not satisfied with my decision is my wife, because it's much less money. 2 weeks ago, Israeli team that didn't say that they are Israeli, they took an interview from a Syrian refugee in Malmö, in Sweden. It's very far from here. It's very close to this point. And the refugee said like this, and look at the anti-Semitic note in his interview. There is no doubt what is going on in Syria is good for defending Israeli borders. Who else could be behind the war and ISIS if not the Mossad? They are the most sophisticated people. They are the smartest around the globe. They assassinated Rabin in order to stop the Oslo agreements. They knocked down Clinton with Monica Lewinsky. They took over Iran, and now they are controlling Assad. They started the Arab Spring in order to keep Israeli border safe. And you know, it reminds me like protocols of all the Zionists. The very famous anti-Semitic note about Israeli that they are both communist and capitalist together. I will tell some words about the Middle East. This is the Middle East as we know it now, but the picture is not showing the truth, because this Middle East doesn't exist anymore. And the only two states that are really national state as we know them from Europe, it's Egypt and Iran. All other states, they are artificial creation. Even a little bit, some people say that Israel is also a colonial creation of Britain. What are the main problems of the region? The religions, the nationalism. In one place it's religion, in other place it's nationalism. Lack of resources, political culture that doesn't fit Europe, colonial heritage, climate, and there is a new idea. It is quite not new that Israel is the turn point of all problems of the world. So I heard from some officials in Sweden that if Israel will disappear, all problems will be solved. Do you believe in this? In the Middle East, and even more now, with the heating of all globe, there is too much desert. Yes. We are not, riding camels, but there is too much desert. There is too much oil. The oil transferred the Arabs into nations that are very rich, but they are not working. And sometimes it's not so good. We see that the prices of oil are changing the world now, even now, and we will talk about in a few minutes. There is too little water. And this is also an advantage because Israel solved the problem of water. I don't know if you know, but Israel is selling the best technologies of desalinated water all around the world, in Africa, in South America, in even the Arab countries are buying from us, Egypt, for example. Who are the key players in this arena? Of course, Russia, Turkey, ISIS, Assad. And here I want to say that from so far away, from Norway, sometimes we don't see the small colors, the small and, you know, very changing colors of the situation. But Syrian opposition, it's about 15 different groups. They are often fighting each other. So this is not ISIS against Assad. It's many, many, many groups against Assad. And in Assad forces, we have also several groups that are fighting from different reasons. Of course, Israel, Iran. And here we see the party of God, Hezbollah. And some people, mostly Sunnis, they say that this is not the party of God. This is not Hezbollah. This is Hezb Shaitan. This is party of Satan. The secondary players in this area, it's Egypt, Saudi Arabia, that from day to day, we are revealing that they are financing many different groups in Sunni Islam and even terror groups. The Arab League. We have here a very prominent actor in this play, Kurds. And if they will be united, maybe they will turn to the primary players, not secondary. Of course, European Union, USA, Palestinian Authority, and Hamas. We have to speak not about Palestinian Authority and Palestinian Authority in the West Bank, or Judea and Samaria, if you prefer, and about Hamas in Gaza, because they are different states. And now, a day, we have almost two Palestinian states, not one. It's the territories and the Gaza Strip. Europa perspective, unfortunately, is only built from two sides, two colors, and two directions, left and right. And really, it's not so easy to understand the world, because maybe it was at the age of French Revolution. Now it's completely different. And the Islam principles, I will, you know, a little bit information for you. This is not radical Islam. I'm talking about regular Islam. So don't be frightened, please. The first principle of Islam, it's the shuhada. Shuhada, it's not shahid, what we know from the suicide bomber. Shuhada, it's the testimony. Testimony, and the testimony is the first sentence of Quran. La Allah illallah wa Muhammad Rasulillah. No God within Allah, and Muhammad is his slave. And sometimes the translation here, there is, and Muhammad his prophet. But it is not true. Muhammad, he is a slave of Allah. Why? Because prophet, it's Nabi. And the Rasul, it's some kind of worker between slave and worker. So if the prophet himself, he's only a slave, he cannot act only as Allah was told him. The second is the Hajj. Every Muslim have to go once his life to Mecca and Medina. Look, Israel and Jerusalem, Al-Quds, it's not here. Because in Quran, Jerusalem wasn't mentioned any time Maybe Muhammad, he was very illiterate. He didn't know about Jerusalem so much. And the third is Ramadan. It's the month of feast. Only the night. They are eating at the nights. Charity, of course, and prayer. And all together of them, creating the Arab world of jihad. Jihad, it's a holy war. And in the hadith, in the tradition of Islam, it's written that all those you can find only by jihad. And jihad you will do in this sentence, Din Muhammad Bil Saif. The law, the force of Muhammad will be got by a sword. Okay? So the Islam itself is dividing the ground of all the globe into two parts. Only two parts there are. There is no part for, neutral force. Only there is a house of Islam, Dar al-Islam, in black, and Dar al-Harb. This is a house of war, and should be permanent war between Dar al-Islam and Dar al-Harb in order to convert all the Dar al-Harb, the white side, into the black, into the Dar al-Islam. And only then Islam will stop. Because this is the aim. This is Islam. It's not only religion. It's mainly ideology. And here in Europe, terror is playing chess, I'm sorry to say. And you, Europe, is playing checkers. And this is why. Because you are not allowed to do many things in order to protect your life. For example, this is profiling of your enemy because you want to be politically correct. I promise you that Israel choose to be not so politically correct, but be alive, either than to be politically correct and to be dead. Shia Islam is very large minority of Islam. It's about 20%. It's only Iran here, and a little bit in Lebanon, a little bit. It's now the majority of Lebanon, the Shiites, but they are not so large amount through all Arabs. There are small parts in Afghanistan and Pakistan, and that's all. And Sunni Islam, it's much larger. It's about 80-85% of all Muslims in the world. And here in the green, we see the Shiites, Muslim. In every place that we have Shiites, we have a fight between them and between Sunnis. As you know, nowadays there is a war in Yemen between Houthis. Those are the Shiites insurgents against the rule of Sunni sheikhs. In every place that we have Shiites, Iran is helping them because Iran is the most powerful Shiite state. Another problem or solution, it's Kurdistan. Kurdistan is the maybe largest Turkish state after Turkey. Kurds are Sunnis, but very moderate, and they are from ethnic origin of Turks. But Turkey is the greatest enemy of Kurds, because Kurdistan is claiming parts of Turkey, Syria, Iraq, and Iran. And nowadays, there are some enclaves of Kurds that are almost independent. It began with the American invasion to Iraq, and they are growing, and they have some successes against ISIS as the armed forces of Peshmerga. They are good soldiers, and according to foreign sources, Israel helped and helping to Kurds in order to stay alive. At the end, there is a production of a terrorist. And I agree completely that the production of terrorists is from the beginning, from the childhood, not only at the elderly years. The problems of Middle East can be solved, and some people are promoting plans in order to divide the borders again. And of course, many people in Europe say that this is not politically correct. But as you see, in Libya, in Sudan, in Syria, in Iraq, there are no borders as we know them. There is no Iraq or Syria as we knew, because there are no such countries, because the people in those countries are very divided, ethnically, religiously, and from other aspects. So you cannot build a solid state without something, some fundament that this is mutual to all parts of the country. And Bernard Lewis, he planned to change the borders of Iraq. And here we see a little bit of previous division in Syria, because in Syria, Assad belonged to the Alawi minority, and Alawis are only 3% of Syrians. And most of Syrians are Sunnis, but we have there Christians. They are dying every day, and nobody cares. And we have in Syria Assyrians, and we have Aramis, and many other people that lived there in this part of the world maybe 3,000 years. And now they are disappearing. And here in Europe, you hear only about Israel. I was in Lebanon since 1982. I fought there, I was wounded there, and I was at Lebanon all, I can say that main part of my career was in Lebanon. And in Lebanon and close to Lebanon. So I have to say that the ethnic and religious fragmentation of Lebanon, it's very, very difficult to understand. And even us in Israel, when we came to Lebanon in 82, we didn't understand what's going on there. Because at the very close border to Israel, there are Christian Maronites. And then we have Shiites. When we entered in Lebanon, Shiites felt like we are releasing them from the PLO oppression. But then they became the greatest enemies of Israel. And then we have the Sunnis, and we have the Druze, and we have many, many, many other tribes, religions, traditions, and ethnic groups. And, you know, I believe that even in Lebanon, they doesn't know all of them. And we started to help Bashir Ismail, who was the elected president of Lebanon. According to the constitution of Lebanon, the president have to be a Christian. But in 2 weeks, he was exploded by Syrians, organization. And then we lost all sane in Lebanon. And from then, from this time till now, Lebanon is a hostage in Hezbollah hands. And by Hezbollah, Iran is ruling Lebanon. Lebanon doesn't have any independent government. And the army of Lebanon, this is only puppet army. Then we took, this is my private picture that I took in 82. And look at those people. This one. Actually, I was interrogated them in Russian. I was born in Lithuania, and I was brought to Israel as 10 years old boy. And from 79, as you know, I went to the army, and I know Russian and Lithuanian and some other languages. And it was no enough intelligence officer to interrogate them in Arabic, because we have too much prisoners. So I interrogated them in Russian. Why? Because the Russians were training them in Russian camps. This one, he learned in Kiev infantry school. And this one was from Odessa. Not from Odessa, but he learned there, trained. And this one, yes, this in the middle, he was in infantry school in Sevastopol. So from those years, Soviet Union was training, financing, and giving weapons to many Arab organizations involved in order to war, to start war against Israel, because the world was bipolar, United States and Soviet Union. And I am asking if the motivation is same. Who is financing now those terror groups? This is also from my personal pictures. It's a unique picture of Beirut, USA embassy. Maybe one of the very first suicide bombers of Hezbollah, they blown up this embassy, and 242 American officials and Marines were killed in this building in Beirut. And then we are going to Jordan. What is Jordan? Jordan, really, it's just a gift of the British Empire to Emir of Mecca and Medina, who ran away from Saud family, from Saudia, and then he stayed without a country. And then a British mandate divided the Palestine mandate into two parts and gave this part of Jordan, that we know it as Jordan today, to King Abdullah. And Jordan is really a very weak country, and we are helping them as we can in order to keep them stable. We are watching the borders of Jordan, not with Israel. The real border of Israel is not the Jordan Valley. It's here. The border of Jordan with Iraq and Syria and Saudi. And then we are going to Turkey. And I'm asking, is Turkey still the sick man of Europe, as it was said before the First World War? And tell me, please, who is now initiating the refugee migration to Europe? All of them are smuggling through to our Turkish borders. You should know it. And now he is acting as a thief. He takes the wallet of the victim, and then he is coming to him and saying, I want to sell you your wallet. Please pay me. He is opening the borders. Europe, I see that this is very bad, and then they are coming and doing agreements with Turkey in order to stop the smuggling people, hundreds of thousands. And okay, he will get maybe 10 billion euro from Europe, and the migration will not stop, because the migration is the best weapon in his hand against Europe. And I will speak two words about Egypt now, and then about Sinai. You should know that the name of Masr, that Arabs call Egypt Masr today, it's a Hebrew word, and we wrote it in our Bible. So the real name, the first name of Egypt is Takemt, but Arab called it Masr, and really Egypt, it's only one of two national states in the Middle East, and we believe that Assisi has the power to stay a kind of stability in Egypt in order to keep his secular regime staying. And of course, we spoke about Iraq, and you should know that Iraq isn't exist, and it will not be existing, never in the future, and only maybe only as a federal state, not otherwise. There will not be one rule in Iraq, even if the war will end, and the same in Syria. And I want to bring you some words of Arab counselor to the Emir of Kuwait. He said himself, this is not my words, this is the time to think about something unthinkable, to consider the possibility of changing the maps, which were drawn up in a hurry 8 years ago. If I am going with this suggestion to, let's say, French foreign ministry, they will fall down. Today, Iraq is an anachronism. As a state, it lacks historical legitimacy and real politics, and is void of any logic. as other colonies, Iraq was invented in favor of those who came there rather than people who lived there. And what is Islamic Caliphate? You say Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, and the real name is Daesh. In Daesh, it's Dawlat al-Ishmaliyah, and this is the State of Islam. And there is no Syria or Iraq in this world. So sometimes even the terms in Europe are misleading you to conclusions that are not right. And Dar al-Islam, according to ISIS, this is all countries that are ruling by Islam. And they will stop the first stop only when those countries will be Islamic State. And after it, they will start the final war against the Dar al-Harb. And of course, for today, they have the best practices of killing people. And this is very bad and terrible to see it, because nobody can stop it for now. All of people are looking at this and astonished, oh, what we can do, what we can give them in order to stop. The diversion in Syria today is so fragmented that even you can bring this slide I brought 2 weeks ago, and for now it's not true, because there are many places that were conquered back by with Russian help, and the other were going to the Peshmerga, and other were going to other ISIS group. In Ramat Golan, in Golan Heights, in the northern Israel, we have like a French cake of Napoleon. They are liars, you know. Here is Druze, and here is ISIS, and here is Hezbollah, and here is Jabhat al-Nusra and other groups. And really, we don't know what to do because we don't know what flag they are using now. And sometimes they are changing the flag, and the rule is changing. Only we know that we have to help them. And then we are going to Russia. And the big question is, why Russia interfered in this conflict? And I will tell you what I am thinking about. The Russian Federation itself, it's combined from maybe 100 ethnic groups, territories, and small regions, and they are terrifying from dividing a country, a state, into ethnic units. And then we are going to international and national problems of Soviet Union and Russia, and we will find maybe that Putin is acting like a Soviet leader or like imperial Russian leader. As you remember, when the Soviet Union was collapsed, left some Russian-spoken people, ethnic Russians, in many republics around the borders of Russia. And the Russians permanently are working to help them in order to keep them alive in the national environment. For example, the first one was Moldova and Pridnestrovia. You should know that one of the fewest communist states still existing, this is the country of Pridnestrovia. There are statues of Lenin and Stalin, and this is not in Albania. This is in Pridnestrovia. They have their own army, border control. They speak Russian. This green part, and they are fighting Moldova, because Moldovans are Romanians mostly, and they are not ruling Kishinev, they are not ruling this part of country, and Russians are helping them with money, with volunteers, and even army units that dress like civilians. I don't want to speak more, because you know my flight back is through Moscow, so in Georgia, we heard about the war when maybe 10 Russian divisions invaded to Georgia, and they almost, destroyed independence of Georgia. But then Russian troops invaded to South Ossetia and Abkhazia, and nowadays the Tbilisi government is not ruling in those places. In those places, they are ethnic Georgians, but they are Muslim Sunnis, and they are under Russian influence and Russian army. So look how many problems involved in this maybe Gordius knot, like here and here. And the next problem is the Asian countries that were former unions, United Soviet Union, and for example, Tajikistan nowadays is the biggest way for narcotics from Afghanistan and Pakistan to Europe. And I believe that some of Russian officials, border control, and many other prominent people, they are taking their taxes from narcotic smuggling into Europe. 2 weeks ago, the fight between Azerbaijan and Armenia became true, and the war never ended. And you have two enclaves into the states. One is Azerian enclave in Armenia, here, Nagorno-Karabakh, and here also the part of Azerbaijan that inhabited by Armenians, and therefore for nowadays Armenia is ruling about 20% of Azer's territory. Azerbaijan for Israel is a very important state, because we are getting much of our oil from Azerbaijan, from Baku, through pipes. They are lying from Azerbaijan, from here, through Georgia and Turkey to Israel. And Azerbaijan is a Shia state, but quite moderate. And we see it like a forepost against Iran. And I have been there several times. And the Israeli army is helping to Azerbaijan army in order to be more strong. And then we are going to the war in Ukraine. And the Malaysian plane, of course, that didn't solve the problem yet. And the question is, whose is bigger? You know, the Russians are playing with the United States in the same play of imperial power. And unfortunately, Ukrainians forgot that they are living not in Mexico. They are living under the bear. And in Russian eyes, look at this picture. In Russian eyes, they see United States as a death. In every interference of United States, it left after her blood. So in Pakistan and Iraq and Libya, in Syria and in Ukraine, Russians say that this was American plot in order to fight Russia. And in 94-95, I served in Israeli embassy in Kiev. And in this picture that I brought here, I am not a prophet, believe me. But even then, I thought about Russia, and I said to myself, it's not possible that they will leave Ukraine alone. Look, in the Old Testament, in the Bible, is written in Hebrew, that for Israel, mitzafon tipatach hara'a, from the north, the evil will come. And why from the north? Because all empires in the history, they came to Israel from the north, and Babylon, and Assyrians, and Greeks, and Persians. And I said here in this photo that for Ukraine, the evil will not come from the north. It will come from the east. And look at this. This is the exact place that I put my hand. All eastern parties of Ukraine are under unrest and under dangerous of Russian invasion because they have Russian population. And as I said previously, they want to protect Russian population. This is one of the biggest problems of Russia today, the demographic problem, and we will see it now. And of course, the annexion of Crimea that have been done for now, and nobody in the world can stop it. And then Russians have their own problems with Muslims. Chechnya in 91, and the Chechens proclaimed themselves as an independent Ichkeria state. And then Russians sold Chechnya to a big mafiosi, and then he is running Chechnya nowadays like a greater sheikh of the Islamic world. And they wanted to establish Caucasus Emirate, and maybe this is the next step of the global Islam. But we have to remember that not every peacemaker is Chamberlain, and not every dictator is Hitler, and I am not saying that Putin is so bad as we can imagine. The inner problems of Russia, it is a decline of the oil prices because Russia is not producing nothing, only resources. And because of that, I believe that for Norway, the decline of those prices are not a disadvantage, it's only advantage. Because it forced the country that producing oil to produce more other things, maybe green energy, maybe windmills, maybe hydroelectric power and other, alternative ways to produce and to put the money with good reward. And the corruption in Russia is mostly famous, so I don't want to speak. I was amazed in Norway that you don't have money, only cards. It's very nice. It's very good against the criminal world. I wish in Israel it was be the same. And we are going to the demographic change in Russia. For now, they are not saying, but maybe only half of Russian population is Russian. All others are Muslims. And because of they are so terrified from ISIS influence in Russia. And in ISIS, about 3,000 of warriors are from former Soviet Union. So they're a very significant part of their armed forces of ISIS. And of course, in every dictator state, the question is who next? The dynasty will end. And then we are going to Iran problem. Iran problem, maybe for Russia, it's an advantage. I am saying the Israeli look, okay? And between Russia and the Khamenei, there is a nuclear problem that we just forgot because of the agreement between Obama and Iran. But what will be with the efforts of Iran to create a bomb? And Russia is selling very best weapon systems to Iran, and Israel is very, very, very worried about. And because of that, we started direct talks with Putin, and I will show you in a minute. And then we are going back to Hezbollah in Lebanon and in Syria. And Hezbollah, it's a Shiite party, Shiite military organization, and they are Iran proxies, definitely. And they are acting all around the globe. Please recall the two explosions in Buenos Aires. Hundreds of people, of Jewish and others, lost their lives there. And the struggle with Turkey today is not only because of the plane that what was crashed in the air. As I said, these are many, many problems. Turkey, the migrants, and of course the influence of Turkey in Azerbaijan, and so on. This is not only the plane and the fight with ISIS. And then we are going to Egypt. This I found in one of the, anti-Israeli sites in the web. So you see the receipt for anti-Israeli Middle East pie. It's very good receipt. I suggest to women and to men to try it in your kitchen. One Russian plane, one Egyptian Sinai, one ISIS group, one cellular phone, and one small Israeli chip. Why? Because they say that in every cell phone in the world, there is an Israeli production. So Israelis shut down the Russian plane. But real, we are protecting our borders, and this is the new border with the on the southern Israel, Negev and Sinai. You should know that what we see, not always what is real, because down the fence and above and inside, we have many and many and many systems that we put in order to keep the border safe. As a specialist of C4I, command, control, communication, and computers and intelligence, I was serving many years, and one of my latest projects was the communication systems and computer system in those fence around Israel. So this is not enough. And even the biggest military specialist, Guderian, said that if the obstacle have no troops on him, this is not an obstacle. So we have also to put here units and many soldiers in order to fight the terror that's smuggling from Sinai to Israel. And the situation in Syria, Russia and Syria together, although Putin said that he is withdrawing from Syria, this is not true. And of course, the problem of Europe today, refugee or migrant, and for God's sake, does it matter? Hundreds of thousands of people, among them the terrorists too, they are coming to Europe, and maybe in some places there is no such world, national country. What is going on in Malmö, in France, in Belgium, in Holland, in Spain? You are losing your countries. Hello, people. The numbers are enormous. I took it in March, 2-3 weeks ago. It's about millions of people that are moving. It's like the time of Tataro-Mongols in Europe in the first century in our history. The world is changing, and you have to do something. Otherwise, you will not exist for long. And of course, this is very frightening to Europe. And I'm saying that Khalifat, his arm is in Brussels already. Look at the numbers of terror acts, and I put it only the prominent one. In 2001, it was assassination of Ahmed Shah Massoud. He was a very famous Kurd leader that he was fighting the Sunnis' influence in this area. And then the terrorists to Madrid came from Brussels. And 191 people were killed, but how many hundreds were injured, and they are now not living as people, but as vegetables. And the strike against Jewish Museum, and in a year ago, Charlie Hebdo killing, and Hyper Kasher, and the terror act in Paris train, and the Paris massacre, and just now in Brussels, it was coordinated attack against very important places in the capital of Europe. And maybe Brussels can be a capital of Khalifat, because that this is no national label in this town. It's not Wallon town, and it is not Holland city, and there is no one police, and there is no one hand that is running this town and this city of Brussels. And there is a direct bridge between Raqqa and Brussels. And I'm saying that the war against terror will not pass over. And what all issues that you are not dealing with, they will come to you. And nowadays, there is a complete ethnic cleansing in many, many, many places in the Middle East. And Europe is speaking about Palestinian Authority and Israel. And I'm asking if Israel will create a Palestinian state, does ISIS will stop killing? We have our coordination with Russia. We understand that that Russia is a very prominent key actor in this area. But basically, I believe that Bibi is saying to Mr. Putin that Israel has his own red lines. And as you see, we didn't stop fighting Hezbollah. We are continuing bombing the convoys with weapons to Hezbollah. And we don't care if Russians sit in Latakia or not. Israel have to defend population and land. We always will have asymmetry with Arabs and Muslims, because in 22 Arab and Muslim states around Israel, there is about 1 million people, and we are only, as you know, 8 million in Israel. We cannot accept defeat, because in the time that we will be defeated, we will not exist anymore. And the previous choice of us was USA. Maybe it's not so appropriate these days. Maybe we'll change the pattern to Russia. And I'm closing to the end. I'm sorry. What are Israeli objectives for now? Guarding the borders, and I said about the Israeli east border, we are preventing terror from flowing in from Gaza, Lebanon, and Syria. We are preventing the delivery of weapons from Hezbollah to Hamas. You see, this is a collaboration between Shia party and Hamas Sunni party against Israel, because we are not allowed to be in the Middle East anymore. Avoiding a direct confrontation with Russia, and we want to reestablish Turkish-Israeli diplomatic relations because it's very good to Israel, as I said, from many, many, many aspects. We will not interfere directly in the Islamic conflict, even if they say that we are already interfered. We will provide humanitarian aid to the injured people in Syria. As you know, we established a military hospital in Golan Heights, and we are dealing with many, many injured people from Syria. We are not asking them who they belong to. Oh, nice. Nice, yes. So we are not asking them what organizations they work for. We are only healing the injured people. And since the war began, we maybe treated about 3,000 Syrians in our hospitals. And show me, please, another European hospital around the borders of ISIS. We are preparing the army and the state for the next rounds, because it will be the Gaza Second War and maybe the third. And we are monitoring and trying to avoid Iran's efforts to get the bomb. We will not take side in the Russian-Ukrainian confrontation. You know, in Israel, we have Jews that came from Ukraine and Russia both, and they, in Israeli media, they are fighting each other. I know this because I am a Russian observer in Russian-spoken TV. I am working for two channels, RTVI and Channel 9. So one is pro-Russian, one is pro-Ukrainian. In every place, I am saying the same. So they are laughing. Take a side. I don't want to take a side. We will help Egypt to struggle with ISIS in Sinai, and we will prevent Hamas to dig tunnels into Israel. Somebody said that Israel invented a new weapon that can create an earthquake. Because of that, the tunnels are collapsing in the southern part of Israel. And some people say that we are providing cement to Hamas, and we are putting then sensors in order to know to what aim the cement is going. And if it's going to build a tunnel, we know where is it. We are watching the borders. We're trying to stop terror. And of course, there is a problem of education. And nowadays, we have small child that are going with knives and stabbing people. And of course, it's very bad. And believe me, even a soldier there that is shooting, and then he sees that it is a young boy, it's not so pleasant to him, and he have to have psychological help. You know, one of my students that went to the army yesterday sent me a picture that he got an award. It was only a letter, because in Israel we don't have medals so much. He got a letter, and his high commander, the chief of staff, said to him, thank you, because he's a paramedic, and he helped one of stabbed people, and he saved his life. So I'm very proud that I'm acting also through education in this conflict. We are paying back. This is the son of Shaitan, son of Satan, one of the prominent terrorists, and he lost his life several months ago. He was Samir al-Kuntar, terrorist, that made a terror act in northern Israel, in Nahariya, 20 years ago. And then he was released in one of the deals of changing dead people, dead Israeli soldiers, to live terrorists. And he went back to terror. And then he lost his life, because this is not healthy to deal with Israel. As you see, we bombed the Syrian reactor in order to avoid all efforts to get atomic weapons around Israel. And in the Turkish situation, as I said, you see this picture is from Marmara. It is an Israeli seal during the trying of conquer Marmara. And as you see, they almost killed, and then we shot, and we have to shoot, because they act as soldiers. So, of course, it was not so pleasant in the world to show that we killed some civilian people, but they came to Israel. We didn't came to Turkey. And we are providing military aid, and we are trying to formate new forces against new threats. And as you know, we are trying to avoid Iran, but since the agreement with Obama, nobody speaks about. And this is not a problem that have been solved. It only was, it went to sleep. My prediction, there will no borders, and small nations will disappear, like Yazidis, like Kurds in many parts, like Assyrians, like Christians. You know that only one country in the Middle East that Christians are flourishing is in Israel. And I'm not saying that there is no problems, because in Israel we also have Daesh. We have also our private ISIS, the ultra-Orthodox Jewish Nazis. It will not be an international law, no human rights, no moral, no deterrence. It will be years of chaos and millions of migrants. And it will be disintegration of Iraq, Syria, Libya, Lebanon, as we know them today. What we have to do? We have to improve power, commando, UAV. UAV, it's unmanned air vehicles, air force, special units, intelligence, electronic warfare, and human resources. We will find new allies, Druzistan, Kurdistan, Alawistan, Azeristan, and Turkmenistan. We will work with every player that want to play with us. And we will guide and strengthen old allies like Jordan, Egypt, and Saudi Arabia, even if they doesn't know as allies. What can we offer? We can offer, of course, the solving of water problem, desalination of water. We can offer to the world intelligence, anti-terror doctrine. We can offer Palestinian demilitarized independent state with Israeli border control if they want, and they don't want for this moment. High-tech, natural gas, stability, and coexistence, and Israeli experience in many fields. It's not enough place to provide all fields that Israel can help the world. Thank you very much.